If your life is a mess, I can guarantee you're not praying to God as you should. I can guarantee that. If the church is a mess, it's because too many people are still wrapped up in the world instead of understanding what Christ has said. In 1 Corinthians 3, he points out the problem. He gives a solution. He says in verse 4, "For while one said, I am Paul, and another, I am Apollos, are ye not yet carnal?" Why are they doing that? Why would it even enter their minds to call themselves after Paul and Apollos? Something influenced them to do that. It was not God's word. It was not Paul and Apollos. They did not tell them to do that. Why did they feel that it was necessary to do that? Why did they start dividing themselves up? Because they're still carnally minded. They're still thinking like the world, because that's what the world does. Another illustration. How many times does the church hate what denominations do? Why do we do it? Why did Israel want a king? 1 Samuel chapter 8, to be like the nations round about. You mean the nations that God told them to drive out of the land? They wanted to be like those nations. They wanted to be like the nations that fell down before Baal or Dagon or Molech. They wanted to be like them. Well, they got a king. You have a king. His name's Jehovah. Well, that wasn't good enough. He wasn't good enough when they came out of Egypt. They thought Moses was. They thought Moses was their leader. Let's make another captain. Let's get rid of Moses and make another captain. Well, you can kill all Moses as you want to. God's going to appoint his own leader, and God's really leading you, not Moses. Moses is a placeholder there, but God is the one that's leading you. They rejected God. Brethren, sometimes in the church, we want to be like all the religious people around us instead of doing what? Instead of turning to the Bible and saying, what does God want us to do? You know, King Saul learned an important lesson, did he not? He learned an important lesson. He learned a lesson. Maybe he did not learn a lesson. He learned it too late. We should learn a lesson. He was told to utterly destroy the Amalekites, and he kept the king and the best of the flocks and herds. Why? Well, the people wanted to. They wanted to have this great celebration. And Samuel said, does the Lord have his great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obedience? In other words, God wanted Saul to obey. That's what would please God. But oh no, we have to do this because the people want to do this. And then sometimes brethren and the church get involved in things because they see the denominational world doing those things. What does the Bible say? What does the Bible teach? I have planted. Apollos watered, and God gave the increase. Notice what's being left out in the minds of those people. Paul points out to them, Apollos and I are partners in this. We're planting and watering. Sometimes Paul would plant, Apollos would water. Sometimes Apollos would plant, Paul would water, right? But God gives the increase. It's God's word that contains the power. It's God's word that has to be followed. It's God that will add to the church. God gives increase in Isaiah 55, verses 10 and 11. And the word of God shall not return unto him void. But we come to 1 Corinthians 3, and they're carnally minded. Interesting, in verse 7, Paul says, so then, neither is he that planted anything, neither he that watered, but God that giveth the increase. In other words, the glory goes to God. Paul said, I don't know. Paul says that it doesn't matter who the person is. We're just instruments in God's use in the word being taught. And God gives the increase. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and what? Glorify your Father which is in heaven. Not glorify us. Glorify your Father which is in heaven. That's the goal. That's the aim. Not to receive glory for ourselves. said, I will build my church, Matthew 16:18. We have to be careful. We do not have spiritual fellowship with religious denominations, nor can we divide ourselves up and risk our own fellowship with one another. We have to be able to maintain and understand that our fellowship with God is based upon His Word. His Word. Being faithful in His Word. Isn't it amazing what people misunderstand what they divide over? It's amazing to me the number of things people think they read in the Bible. Every year, we go through certain things. Apple. How many people believe that Adam and Eve ate an apple? One, the text doesn't say. The text just calls it fruit. We usually say forbidden fruit because it was forbidden. It was just forbidden fruit. The word fruit, just a generic term. We don't know what kind it was. The religious world in many cases says it was an apple. Sometimes I hear brethren say it was an apple. Three wise men. We don't know how many wise men there were. The Bible just says wise men. There were three different kinds of gifts. Gold, frankincense, and myrrh. For some reason, I'm assuming that people think that each man gave one particular kind of gift. So if there were three different kinds of gifts, there were three wise men. But how do you know they didn't each give the same thing? That they didn't mix and match those things like you do coal sometimes, right? Go to the store, mix and match your pants and your shirt, your pants and your coat, all that type of thing. How do we know that? We know. The Bible says they were wise men. We know there were two or more. That's all we know. Sometimes I hear Brenda talk about three wise men. Why? Because they're still babes. They're still babes. They still do not understand. I've had people introduce me sometimes, not in the church, in our society. This is our pastor. They still do not understand that the term pastor is reserved for the overseer or the elder of the church. The religious world has that confused, I know. Brethren, we ought to understand the use of the word. But I know brethren who have been in the church for 20 and 30 and 40 years who still don't know. Why not? Because they're still babes. They're still babes. They just have not learned. How many sermons does it take for a person to obey the gospel? Depends upon his knowledge, doesn't it? Depends upon his knowledge. Some people, they hear, they've been reading, they've been studying, they hear the gospel, they're ready to obey. There are other people who have not been reading and studying. They need to learn, they need to hear, they need to know. We have to gain the proper amount of understanding in order to obey the gospel. We have to understand what the gospel teaches and what we're supposed to do in order to be saved. How many sermons, how much knowledge does a person need in order to understand he needs to come back to God if he's a wayward child of God? He needs to reach that understanding. We learn in Acts chapter 8 that Simon the sorcerer was rebuked immediately, and he immediately asked for the apostles to pray for him. He was convinced. Sometimes the brethren we wait too long. We just kind of wallow around in our ignorance or our denial. Because we're still babes. We're still carnally minded. What's the answer to that? To grow. To grow. To read the studies and to grow. Do you realize how much information there is today? I sometimes reflect, I'm studying something. And I have my laptop here. I have an iPad here. I have my Bible. I have a dictionary on the internet, and I have other reference books on the internet. I have at home all the pulpit commentary. You know, those are those big, thick ones, right? And I have it all on a disc. I don't have to carry around those big books anymore. Search through the pages. I put in a disc and there's a full picture commentary and I go to where I want and boom. sheds, audio sermons, video sermons. Oh, it is unbelievable what there is out there. I think back to a couple hundred years ago, restoration movement is underway. And all those preachers sitting down with their Bible, standing up by candlelight, reading and studying and writing. Oftentimes those words would be put into books, and we now have those as commentaries and reference books, and now some of those are on this. I sit down to study, and I have all types of helps. You know what I'm doing? I'm warming by the fires that others have made. There was a day in which there would be circuit preachers that would come around. Because every congregation didn't have a preacher, so they had circuit preachers that would come around and would preach. Now we have all of this knowledge at our fingertips. There is no excuse to be ignorant of God's Word. None. The rate at which we can understand and study and grow is unbelievable. The videos that we have at our fingertips, that we can hear sermons, the books, the magazines, the articles that dive into all these subjects. I mean, you can Google, right? You can Google. You have to be careful what you're Googling. You have to be careful the source. But you can go to some reputable websites that have all kinds of articles and all kinds of sermons, and you can put in the search on a particular subject, and boom, there's an article on that subject, and now you've got something that will help you start. There's just no excuse. You pull out your phone and look that stuff up and listen to it on your phone. Not Facebook. Other good stuff. There's just no excuse. I know, you're saying, oh, we're too old now. We're never too old to read and to learn and to study. Why is it important, brethren? So we don't get like the church of Corinth. And carnality overcomes us, and we divide, and we have strife and contention because we lack wisdom, because we lack an understanding of God's Word. And because we have personally grown. Let me take this out of the context of the church. Let me put this in the context of your family. In the context of your family. Husbands and wives are growing in the Word of God. You tell me what that does for your marriage. You tell me what that does for your marriage. That helps. You get your children involved in, are you ready for this? A home devotional. We spent 4 years at Stop 11 Road writing daily devotional material that accompanies the engraving and the truth material so that all the families would be able to have a book with a devotional page that they could study for the next 4 years in their homes. I could not make them do it, but we provided the material to do it. I didn't go to their house and ask them if they were doing it. I encouraged them. We wrote the material. We printed it. We provided it. Here's the outline. Can you read the scripture? Can you memorize the scripture? Can you sing a hymn? Can you read this page? Can you open your Bible? It's right there. What can that do if it's used? That will strengthen. Let me move it out of the family. Let me talk about you. Let me talk about me. What does it do for us as an individual? Husbands, you want to be a stronger husband? Work on yourself. Wives, you want to be a better wife, better mother? Work on yourself. Grow personally. Increase your faith. Increase your knowledge in the Word of God. Do that every day. It will help you as an individual. Everything else can fall down around you, but you will be equipped to handle the problems of life because you're growing in knowledge and in faith. I'm sorry. A lot of problems. A lot of problems in the church, a lot of problems in the brotherhood, a lot of problems in our family, a lot of problems in our own lives. And this is the answer. Same answer Paul gave long ago. Don't forget your fellowship with God. That's everything. Don't jeopardize it, don't risk it. What's the answer? Learn this book. Rid yourself of the carnality and learn this book so that we can be better Christians. Friend, if you're not a Christian, will you obey the gospel this morning? Not a better way to start this day or start this week than to say that I want my past sins forgiven and I want to become a child of God. We come to God through faith, repenting of sins, confessing Jesus' name, being immersed in water, just as God commanded that He will wash away our sins and add us to His church. For the Bible says we become a new creature in Christ. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. Perhaps as an early child of God, you wandered astray. Maybe you're having problems in the family, in the church, with your own life. Things are wrong. Make them right. Make them right. Repent of sin, confess sin, ask God for forgiveness. If you need to grow individually, take care of that person. Convince yourself today that you're going to start ridding yourself of carnality. And you're going to apply the spiritual wisdom that's found from God's Word. If you're subject to the invitation, will you come right now? Always stand and say.